I'm your host, Keith Andrew. Along here is the talented and beautiful Casey Carwell. And I just want to say thank you for being a guest on my talk show.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me on. I appreciate it.
Now, for people who want to know what Uncensored is, Uncensored's my way of showing people that even with a learning disability, I can still overcome controversy and reach my goals in life. At the same time, I'm able to turn myself into a perfect example for people out there dealing with any type of learning disability or disabilities in general, but you should never give up and you should prove to people you can still amount to something. Now, with that being said, it's half hour, 45 minute com season. Say anything you want and call me an asshole for messing up your last name. But, you know, it's your time. It's whatever you want to do.
That's not my style.
So, starting off, I notice you are a professional wrestler. And I try, and I say this to older wrestlers I interviewed. I don't want to be like a wink, wrestling shoot. So I'm going to ask you some easy questions. Yes, we're going to talk about wrestling. But I'm going to ask you some hard-hitting questions, too. And I'm going to put you in the driver's seat. And then you can ask me anything you want. Or if there's anything you want to talk about, this is your time, after all. So it's whatever you want to do.
Answering questions. I'll answer questions all day long.
So starting off, what can you tell us about yourself?
About myself, my name is Casey Carlisle. I have been wrestling for going on 10 years. I started out as a huge fan of professional wrestling, and I told everybody that I would find a way to become a wrestler, and they all just thought it was very cute. I was 8 years old at the time. So they thought it was very cute. They thought it was, you know, like pat me on the head and tell me that's a really nice goal and, you know, go out and play or something. But I set my mind to it, and much like you can probably relate to that, you know, you're not going to take no for an answer, and you just set your mind to it and you decide that's what you want to do and you find a way to do it, and that's basically what I did.
No, I agree with you. You know, when I first started my talk show, I got a lot of people criticizing me, but, you know, it's just about proving people wrong, and most of the time, it's just people reflecting themselves onto you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they could.
A lot of the negativity is because that's, you know, people have negativity in their life, and it's, you know, it's one of those things, like, they just kind of fester that feeling, and they want to share that instead of trying to take steps to find positivity and, you know, positive things to harp on.
Right. And like I said, when people reflect themselves on you, it's like, oh, well, if I couldn't do it, why should you do it? Or, you know, perfect example, and I know this person who said, I went to school and I have a master's in this area, and I'm unable to get a job in broadcasting. Why should I do something that he went to school for? You know, it's kind of like, you know,
well,
what?
You have to come up for it, right?
You know, in a way, but, you know, it's just about proving to people, you know, hey, look at it. I have a learning disability and I have my hands tied, can't go to college, can't do this, can't do that, but I'm like, look at what I'm able to accomplish. You know, it'd be nice to become famous, but at the same time, I'm just making a statement out of it.
Well, can't can be a very ugly word, so it's very important to limit your can'ts and focus more on what you can do and what you do have the control over.
That's true. And now, next question. I don't mean to hesitate. I apologize. I haven't done my interviews as of late.
I'm just hanging out with you right now. It's fine.
Now, the next question I was going to ask you is, who influenced you to become a professional wrestler, and when did you get started?
I got started in the professional wrestling business in 1998 as a manager. That was my first show, was June of 1998. I started, you know, I would have shows here and there, but I wasn't able to fully dedicate myself to it at that time because the job I had at the time, just the hours I worked, a lot of times conflicted with the wrestling. So I wasn't able to really get going with it until 2002, I believe it was. And that's when, you know, the indie full-time schedule of, you know, basically every Tuesday and every Saturday, Sunday, Fridays, if I could, that's when I started really getting involved in the manager aspect of it. My first match was on July 30th, 2005, in Olney, Virginia. So the end of this July is going to be my 10-year anniversary with my in-ring career, which I'm very excited about. But growing up, you know, I was very atypical in the fact that I was, first of all, a girl, you know, and that was still, like, girls are supposed to have Barbie dolls and play tea party, and I didn't. I had Barbie dolls, but they kind of got dusty because I had my wrestlers. When I was 8 years old, I started watching wrestling, and my sister was watching it. She called me in to watch with her, and I thought, this is fantastic, and 2 weeks later, she was over it, and I was still plopped down in front of the TV watching. My biggest influences, in a way, was everybody, because I was so sucked into it and I was so in love with what I was seeing play out before my eyes every week that I just couldn't get enough of it. But if I had to narrow it down, on the female side of things, I was very greatly influenced by Sherri Martel and Leilani Kai and the Fabulous Moolah. I was the girl who liked those, like, the bad girls, you know, like, they were nasty and they were rude, and they weren't very ladylike, but in the ring, they got stuff done, and they were successful, and for some reason, being that 8-year-old girl, that completely spoke to me. And then getting older, I also, like so many other people, had a love for the Shawn Michaels of the world, the, you know, Kurt Hennings, and I always thought Ted DiBiase was fantastic, even as a kid, so I was influenced by a lot of different people, but the core of it all was just my love for it in general, and my love for every single thing about it. I told everyone, that's going to be me one day. I'm going to find a way to make it happen. So anything and everything having to do with wrestling influenced me to keep chasing it and to basically stay in love with it to the second.
Well, if you're interested, I would love to work with you if that's a possibility.
Love to what? What's that?
Oh, I would love to work with you if that's a possibility.
Yeah, no, it's, yeah. Yeah, it's... anything's a possibility, you know? So, I loved it growing up, and, you know, it's the one love of my life that's kind of stayed consistent and hasn't really gone anywhere since I was that 8-year-old kid. So, I've been so lucky and fortunate to have the opportunity to chase that dream and to make it happen, and to be able to continue pursuing it and just take whatever opportunities are presented to me. I'm very lucky in that aspect.
Now, what about some of the women like Trish Stratus, Lita, Malena Perez, Mickey James? Have you ever looked up to them or had a chance to meet them?
I've met a few of them. I can't say that I've looked up to them in the same way that I looked up to the people I mentioned previously, because I was starting to be, I was like in the business when they were coming through. Or, you know, like, was just starting out. So I had a different viewpoint, and I looked at it differently. I looked up to them in the sense of, you are where I want to be. I looked up to them in that sense, but not so much in the role model, you know, patterning myself after them sense, because I had a different point of view at that time. You know, I think that they all, I always respect everybody. Anyone who gets in the ring, male or female, you have to give them a level of respect, because you know that they're putting certain, you know, risks on the line. They're risking their health and well-being, like, you know, anybody else is. You know, I met Lita. I met her very, very early on when she was kind of in between training with Dory Funk and about to debut in ECW. She came by a school down in Richmond, Virginia that I used to train at and eventually help at. And so she was kind of getting a couple workouts in down there. Mickey James, I was around actually when she began training as well. The same guy that trained me is one of her first trainers, and that's Shorty Smalls. And it's funny, I actually have a match coming up against Mickey next Saturday the 16th in Delaware. I'll be defending a title against her, 1CW women's title against her. So that'll be interesting. You know, but yeah, I mean, all these women, like I said, I look up to them in a different way, because it was a different time for me and I had a different point of view. But you have to admire and look up to anybody who has found any level of success, you know, especially the women in this business. The women that you all mentioned are women who are known for being great in-ring competitors. They're not just the women who are known for being in that manager, that valet role. And I think that probably speaks to you as well. You know, there's a reason you picked those women and mentioned them. It tells me that you probably have respect for what they did in the ring just as much as what they might have done outside of it.
Well, after the show, I do have a couple of ideas I'd like to talk to you about. But, you know, one of the things I do want to mention, it's a funny story. When you watch my introduction after the show airs, I used the Bret Hart WCW song. It's funny because he says he hates that song. I like that song. So I put my own spin on it. So, you know, it's funny. You know, season one, what was it? Season one, I used the TNA Impact song, Adrenaline Rush. And I put my own spin on it. Then season two and three, I used the Bret Hart song. And the reason I keep talking about Bret Hart is, you know, for people who are watching, I don't know if you can see this or not, but I have a picture, an autographed picture, and and now for a reason I keep mentioning it, he made a difference in my life. And you know, what I mean by that is, let's see, it was back in 95 or 96, it was 95 or 96, and he was at the Middletown Mall doing an autograph signing. Don't know the whole story, but I know when I showed up, he was annoyed. And he was always, he was signing pass, sign pass, sign pass, and his head was down. And we were online for like an hour, 2 hours. My parents came back. Oh, you still standing here? Well, if this doesn't pick up, we have to go. Don't have time for this. And, you know, just... It's a long time ago, and it's time to remember it. And so it's like, oh, you know, my dad said, do you believe this guy? He's, all these fans are here to get his autograph, and he's not even acknowledging them. His head is down. He's just sign pass. And I said, screw it. I'm going to get his attention any way possible. So my two brothers were in front of me. And so they got the autograph, and his head was down. I thought it was one of my brothers who took my picture and was pulling it. So I got like a death grip on it. So, and as it was being pulled across the table, I noticed it was Bret. And he stopped and he looked at me. I swear to God, I thought he was going to say, hey kid, you want me to sign this or not? But he stopped, looked at me, and smiled. So everyone before me didn't even look at. I don't know if early in the day, you know, he was looking at people. But I'm saying before, when I was there, before I got the chance to him, he wasn't acknowledging anyone. But he looked at me. I got him to look at me, and that made a difference in my life.
Yeah. I can imagine it did. That must have been a good feeling.
And most recently, I know I mentioned Malena Perez, and I got her autograph. And I did ask if she wanted to be on my show, but she said she wasn't doing interviews, but she would let me know when she does. And I didn't puss with her. I was like, you know, okay, if that's whatever you want to do. And but she wrote on my autograph, her autograph, because I told her about my talk show and what I'm doing and everything. She says, to Keith, keep showing the world how amazing you are. And that's like, that, it means a lot to me. I can show you afterwards, but if you can see in the picture behind me, I also met Velvet Sky.
Yeah.
And she also got autographed it for me, and I asked her about the show, but, you know, still working on that. But I can't turn the camera because it's focused on you, but I can show you afterwards if you want. I had both photographs blown up to 18 times 24, and I have it hanging on a wall.
Good for you. That's awesome.
Now, passing it back over to you, have you ever met anyone that, like I said, it influenced you or really respected and had the opportunity to be in the ring? You mentioned you're going to be in the ring with Mickie James. Do you guys still keep in contact? Are you guys like good friends or...
And there's no reason for that. It's just one of those things. You know, like I said, the guy Shorty who trained me, was her trainer as well, and so I was there kind of helping out and there. But then she went her way, and I went mine, and no reason for it. We just never were friends, or anything like that. I actually haven't seen her for years and years and years. So when I see her next week, and that'll be the first time in quite a while. But you were asking if I've ever been in the ring with anybody, like influential, or that I looked up
Yes.
to, or anything like that. I'm sure I have been. I'm trying to think. I'm gonna come off sounding completely rude because I can't really think of anybody. I haven't necessarily shared the ring, but I've been in locker rooms and been on shows with people who, who were a superstar or somebody I looked up to as a kid, and I'm not really one to have like those starstruck moments or anything. All the people that would happen with are non-wrestling people, but I always think it's really cool and something that is a little taken for granted, probably, when you have somebody in the locker room with you who, either you used to watch on TV or have at least been there, done that in that sense, as far as just having that person there to give you any advice, just to listen to their stories. I mean, you hear people talk about that stuff all the time, but it's a matter of whether or not you actually do it.
Right.
Even if you just take the minute to watch their match, that's still something that is, being allotted to you that obviously not everybody would have the chance to have. And anytime you can get around anybody who is, who's been wrestling longer than you, or they've worked for companies you want to work for, anything like that, it's always very cool and it's a good experience. You just have to take advantage of it.
Now, did he ever get the opportunity to work for TNA, WWE, WCW, or any big name companies, or?
Did I?
Yes.
Did one dark match for TNA prior to one of their house shows down in Fayetteville, North Carolina, and that was back in 2012. I took part in one of their gut checks, so those were the closest I've ever been to TNA. As far as WWE goes, I was just recently an extra for them twice last year, in a Rosebud capacity. I was the Rosebud back in July, and then again in September. So of course that, was an experience all on its own. The one in September, it was a longer period of time. It was for 4 days, I guess. And again, it's just being offered the opportunities to kind of, see what's being done on a level other than the one you're on, take advantage of it, pick people's brains. It's awesome and it's fun, and that gets you one step closer to knowing what it takes to accomplish whatever goals you might have at that time.
Now, before I ask you the hard-hitting ones, going back to the easy ones, is did he ever do any sports growing up, number one? And were you a study nerd or party animal when you were growing up in college?
I was not a party animal at all, no. I was athletic in school. I ran track and cross country, and I did that year round. It was cross country and then indoor track. My school didn't have an indoor track, so we just ran outside in the snow and the ice. And then it was like the regular track, and then over the summer we would start prepping for cross country again. So I literally ran year round for not my freshman year, but sophomore through senior year. I was a runner. I did some cheerleading like back in middle school, but not really for me. Other than that, I was a runner. That's what I did all the time. That, and I paid attention to wrestling. And I was not a party animal at all in high school. I wasn't really a bookworm either. I was kind of, in between. Like, I got fair grades, but I wasn't the person studying all night and all day. But I wasn't a partier either. I would come home and spend time with my family and just kind of chill and take it easy. It wasn't one extreme or another.
All right. Then the next question I was going to ask you was, did you ever get the chance to do one of those human pyramids? Sorry, not a human pyramid, girl.
A human pyramid?
Yes.
No, I've never done a human pyramid before.
Yeah, I love
I don't
that
think I
stuff.
ever would. I don't think I'm not very trusting. I wouldn't be trusting of the other people in the pyramid.
Well, if you're interested, I love that stuff. Maybe you can help me do one day.
I don't know. I might just watch from afar. far, but you never know.
Now, the next question I was going to ask you is, what's your opponent? And I came up with this idea, and if you want to go half on the idea with me, I'm looking for people who want to sponsor it. And there's this thing I came across called invent, oh, was it idea invention or oh, invent an idea. And basically, you pitch an idea, and if they like it, they turn it into a product. And I said, well, I'm a big wrestling fan. Wouldn't it be really cool to have someone like you, for a perfect example, someone like you or me, and turn, have a copy and turn it into like a mannequin and have like a full-size person as a mannequin, and it's like then reenact wrestling moves on it. And it's like, oh, that's a good idea, but then no one was very interested. So the reason I brought it up is, how do you guys practice your reenacting wrestling moves, or when you're in the ring, you just whatever happens, happens. So like, how do you know, okay, I'm gonna say you gotta kick my ass and you gotta do a suplex on me. Do you practice it, or do you just say whatever happens, happens?
My hope would be if the person is in a match, then they've been trained.
Right.
That's the hope. And training is the practice. So if somebody is booked in a wrestling match and they're in the ring already, then practice time has already come and gone and it's showtime. And they need to know what they're doing and be ready for it. If I'm going to go suplex somebody, I'm just picking that chick up and I'm suplexing her. I'm not going to, there's no practice. That's what training is for. And that's why you hear so many wrestlers talk about training and quality of training and make sure you go to good schools and make sure you're getting trained by people who know what they're doing because it's a domino effect. So if somebody doesn't have good training, that's when injuries happen. That's when you see people getting hurt, doing stupid things or things that they shouldn't even be trying. If I'm in a match with somebody, then the time to practice and train has already come and gone, and that window's closed. And we're wrestling a match now. It's time to be out there and wrestle the match and, be prepared for that. If they still need to practice on stuff, then they're in the wrong place.
Has it ever happened to you? Say, like, you went to pick someone up and they didn't even budge, and it's going, now, is it about selling, or is it, are you actually lifting the person up and it's kind of like dead weight?
If I ever find myself in the ring with somebody who shouldn't be in the ring, then I just make very short work of them and that match doesn't last very long.
Well, has that ever happened to you?
It has, not often, thankfully. I don't have much patience for that and I don't tolerate it very much. And I think that it's kind of well known, don't put an untrained person in there with me because I just don't have the patience for it. It's stupid, and there's no point to it at all, other than somebody being arrogant and being, untrue with themselves as far as their ability or lack thereof. It doesn't happen often, but when it has happened, like I said, the match didn't last all that long at
Right.
all, unfortunately.
Now, I don't know if you know, but Beth Phoenix used to, she's retired now, and she used to have this thing, and she's the first woman that I know of in professional wrestling who was able to pick up two women at the same time. And she picked up Malenna and Mickey at the same time, and then she also picked up Gail and Gail, Gail and Gail Kim, Gail Kim and Kelly Kelly. Do you think that's just pure strength, or do you think all that's orchestrated too? Like, it's practice.
Oh, Beth Phoenix is a strong girl. I mean, you obviously know that if, you've watched her matches, then she's an incredibly strong girl. Obviously strength has a ton to do with that. Anytime you're able to lift two people up, then you can't be weak and have a weak core and do that. So, obviously that's a strong person who does that.
What about you? You think you're able to pull it off?
I'm sure I could if I wanted to, or if I tried. I haven't been in that position really, where I've had a need to pick up two girls at one time, so, but if I wanted to, if I'm having a good week and feeling strong, probably.
Going to ask you the next question, and it's a guy question, so I don't mean any disrespect. And When you guys get kicked in the stomach and the girls grunt or sigh, is that like you're actually doing it? Is that actually when you're sighing, or is that actually a recording of when you're, because WWE has sound effects. So is that just like a sound effect that they play over and over, or is that when...
Are you talking about during the match if you get kicked in the stomach? No, there's no... I mean, I'm not speaking for WWE. In my matches, if I kick somebody in the stomach, trust me, they're grunting because it hurts. And vice versa. There's no sound effects or anything like that, no.
Well, I didn't mean to cut you off. I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. That's fine. I was just saying it's not even close to sound effect. If I were to come and kick you in the stomach, you would be making the sound that you're referring to because it would hurt. So that's on the sound effect thing. That's an "ow, my belly hurts" thing.
I didn't mean for it to sound perverted. I apologize if I...
No, it wasn't perverted at all. It's just, it's a reaction to being kicked in the stomach. It's not a good feeling at all. So definitely not sound effect.
Now the next question, actually I'm going to pass the show over to you now. Is there any subjects you would like to talk about? Anything that motivates you or gets you fired up?
Not really. I'm here to answer questions from you, my friend.
Right.
I really don't. I'm pretty standard. I kind of, you know, same thing day in and day out with me.
Now, do you wrestle in the New York area? Like, do you travel or...
I travel all over the place, yeah. I've been up to New York a few times, and I'll be headed back up that way this fall.
Well, if I would love to hang out with you, if that's a possibility.
Oh, there's two conventions up that way I'll be part of. That's already definite. They're in October or November, so you'll have to keep an eye out on my Facebook page.
Now, the next question I was going to ask you, like I asked the easy questions, then I asked some wrestling questions. You mentioned, you're hinting towards the mug you have. It says Diva on it. That's pretty cool, actually.
Oh, it does. I wasn't even thinking about it, but yes, it was a gift, and it says Diva.
You mentioned you're going to defend a title, and that brings up my next question. How many belts have you won, and do you have any belts around that you can show us, or?
How many have I won total in my career?
Yes, and do you have any on you?
Yeah, I do have some here. I can't tell you how many I've won total in my career because I never kept track, to be honest with you. I currently hold 5. As far as total, I would have to sit here and think about it and get back to you because I would have to go back through all those 10 years of thinking through. But I have a few of them home. Yeah, they're not incredibly handy. I could get one if I put my phone down for a second if you want to look at my ceiling. But, I have them here, but I currently hold 5.
Well, if you're okay with it, I would love to see it. But it's up to you. I don't mean to impose on you.
Are you with me?
Yep. That's nice.
You're able to see that? That's the Queen of the Valkyrie title. Valkyrie Women's Professional Wrestling. It is an all-women's promotion that's based in New York, New Jersey. Their next show is Thursday, July the 9th in Woodbury Heights, New Jersey. So hopefully everybody has enough notice to mark their calendars. This is the Elite Pro Women's title. I will be defending this title tomorrow night in Petersburg, West Virginia, against Tessa Valentine. They're based in West Virginia. And this is the ACW women's title.
That's really nice.
I just won this one. This is my third reign with this title. I just won it back from Serafini about a month ago up in Pennsylvania. And I'll be defending that one for the first time in July as well. That won't be my first Valkyrie defense, but that'll be my first defense of the ACW title since I regained it.
Hey, if you're interested, I would love to take some pictures of those belts.
You'll have to come to one of the shows I'm on, won't you?
I know it's a women's belt, but, you know, it's still a belt to belt.
It is, yeah. It's title belt to title belt.
Now, the next question, I was going to ask you 3 hard-hitting questions. And the first one is, where do you stand on life after death? Do you think There's more, some people say,
Yeah.
or you don't have to answer it. That's completely up to you.
I think there is life after death. I believe in it, but I'm not somebody that can sit here and debate all of these wonderful points forever and ever. It's not something that I read up on all the time or anything like that, but I believe in it. Yes, I believe that, it's possible for somebody's spirit to remain and still exist even after their physical body has died. So in that sense, I believe in that, yes.
No, absolutely. I feel the same way. And I do believe in heaven and hell, yin and yang, because there always has to be a balance, up and down, left and right, good and bad. There's always a balance, and I don't think this is it. I always think this is like a test, and then when you make your journey over to the next life, it's, it's funny, I always said, if I die, would I do my life over? I would, only under certain circumstances. So I would do it, only knowing everything I know now. I would like to see how things would be different. Like, I would have, per, kept, I used to work in retail, and I had a good job, but I kind of screwed that up for myself. And so I would have, gone back, made sure to keep my mouth shut and kept the job. Then I would have started my talk show a lot sooner, instead of having my head up my ass and doing absolutely nothing. And I bet you
Those
just
are
think
learning experiences. That's a life experience.
that's true. And I bet you feel the same way. If you knew things now, you would have gone a lot sooner. You would have done this sooner.
I'm also of the belief that everything happens for a reason, and if you go back and start wishing you had changed things, then you're also changing the path that your life takes, and you may not have good things that have happened to you since then. Because you went a different way, so I try not to dwell on the past too much.
Right.
We all do to a certain extent, but I try not to do it too much because every decision and every choice and everything that happens is what makes us who we are today. And if you change one little thing about that, then you could be worse off than you think you are now or in a worse situation. So I try to look towards the future and worry about the present time.
Yeah, absolutely. And now the next question I was going to ask you is, where do you stand on women's rights?
Like what? It depends. It's hard to say women's rights because that's all very opinion based as far as what women's rights are, should be, what's considered equal and what's not. To tie it back into wrestling, that's one of those things where you hear people conversing about whether or not intergender matches should be allowed and are they bad? Are they good? And that's something people flip-flop on all day long, back and forth. One day they want women to have the same opportunities and to wrestle the same types of matches, and then the next day those matches are too violent for women to be in, or the guy was too big or something. So it's hard to say. That's such a broad subject, and the thing is, it's always opinion. There's never going to be a fact about what's good or bad or right or wrong when it comes to that type of thing. So that's something that's going to be debatable for centuries and centuries to come.
Hey, now the last subject I was gonna ask you is this: if you, I don't know if you watch the news, but it's legal in some states, and you may know where I'm gonna get was this. Where do you stand on legalizing marijuana? And do you think if you're in a state that it's legalized, would you wrestle when you're smoking, or would you wrestle someone who has been smoking? It's like, okay, it's legalized. I said, I don't know, California, and you have a match, and half of the people are there stoned out of their minds. So would you still say, okay, I have a job to do, but would you be like,
That's like anything else. That's hoping that people are responsible with their own decisions, and kind of are able to gauge in that environment, in that type of situation, what a good decision would be, what a bad decision would be. I'm not going to walk up to people, every person I wrestle, and say, "Hey, have you been smoking weed today?" I'm just not going to do it. It's One, it's none of my business. Two, like I said, you know, we all make our own decisions. And so if I get into a ring with somebody and they're unsafe, just like I was saying earlier, whether it's because you haven't been trained, you've been drinking all day, or you've been token up all day, if I feel like I'm in an unsafe situation, then that situation will come to a close very quickly. If I don't, then it won't. For me, it's that simple. You know, I'm not police. I'm not the police of the world. I'm not the police of everybody. We all make our own decisions and do what we want to do, and that's fine. That's the beauty of living in this country and us being humans. You know, that we're all going to make our own decision and do what we choose to do. And everyone has to make their own decision, and I make my decisions. I don't care what anyone else thinks about them, or, you know, because they're mine. And I'm the same way like that about other people. So, you know, that's never crossed my mind. And going forward, it's so not an issue in my mind at all. I don't even give it any thought, to be honest with you.
No, I feel the same way. And, you know, I say to people, you know, as long as you're responsible and you don't use it endanger anyone, you can do whatever you want. You know, that's the same thing with drinking. You have to be responsible, and you know, you have the right to do whatever you want, period. However, you have the right to, at the same time, and a responsibility to be responsible for everything, your actions. Now, you can't do things half-ass, and then you can be like, oh, well, I did this, or, you know, I wasn't really paying attention, or I was careless. You know, you have to pay attention to what you're doing. And I know you've probably done this, and I know I have done this, or you just went off and did it, but you didn't really think of the repercussions. But, you know, like I said, it's life. It's a learning experience. But at the same time, you have to be, you know, responsible if when it has to do with other people, you know what I mean?
Well, that applies to every aspect of life. I mean, you know, I could be drinking a bottle of water in the grocery store and dribble some on the floor. Now, am I a bad person because I don't wipe it up because someone could slip and fall? I mean, you can. Every part of life is about being responsible and making your own decisions. That's every single aspect of life.
That's,
you know,
true.
It's just a matter of you. If I make the decision and the choice to get in the ring and wrestle somebody, then I'm making that decision and that choice. You know, and their choices that they've made have nothing to do with that choice that I made. So it's, to me, it's a very broad subject and a very broad viewpoint. It's not so honed in on right and wrong.
No, I agree with you. Now, wrapping up, do you have anything you want to say to your fans and listeners? If your fans want to follow you, are you on Twitter, Facebook?
I am all over social media. The easy way that I put it these days is to Google my name and you'll find me. But I'm on Twitter at Casey Carlisle. I'm on Facebook. I have my regular profile page, which is Casey Carlisle. I have a fan page, which is one of the like pages, facebook.com/CaseyCarlisleFanpage. My website is CaseyCarlisle.com, where you can see my upcoming appearance schedule, photos and videos from my matches, merchandise, my DVDs and 8x10s that you can order. I also have my YouTube channel, which is Casey Carlisle, for anybody who wants to watch some of my matches. I'm all over the place, and I always just say thank you so much to the fans who support me and have supported me through all these years, and the new fans who are just now, you know, coming into my world. I just thank everybody. I always say to everybody, I appreciate it, and it means so much to me. And, you know, you read those words online, and sometimes it feels like they're just being said, but for me, they're very genuine. I appreciate everybody's support, everybody who, you know, keeps track of me and keeps track of my career. It really does mean a lot to me, so thank you.